For the Lamb has conquered, and I will follow him to the end of the earth, and I will follow him. Jesus, you're worthy of every tribe and tongue. It's all for your glory, till every soul is one. For the Lamb has conquered, and I will follow him to the end of the earth, and I will follow him. Jesus, your word of every tribe and tongue, it's all for your glory, till every soul is one. Harvest is ready, we have to go. We won't stop till the whole world knows the power in your blood to save every soul. We're not ashamed of the gospel. The harvest is ready, we have to go. We won't stop till the whole world knows the power in your blood to save every soul. We're not ashamed of the gospel.
Good morning, church. We're glad you're here. We got a special Sunday today where we'll have a missions emphasis, and that's why we sang that song to open things up today. But join us now as we sing this next song, Even So Come, Lord Jesus.
All of the earth, make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saint, let every nation shout of your fame. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for a groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus, come. Even so come, Lord Jesus. Is coming soon. we wait your coming soon. So we wait for you. God, we wait your coming soon. Like a bride.
God, it's with eager hearts that we anticipate your coming. And I pray that even now we would be a church that's ready for you, sold out for you and your gospel, sharing the good news of hope that's found in Jesus with the whole world. We look forward to being with you again. Amen. You can be seated.
Good morning. Welcome to Alliance Church. My name is Chris. I'm one of the pastors here. Welcome to you who are here in person and also to you who are joining us online. What better place to be than here today to learn about God, to navigate His Word, and to fellowship with each other? I've got a couple of announcements to get us started here this morning. If you turn your attention to the bulletin, if you feel at all led to give to any of the ministries here at Alliance Church, you can do so online by going to myalliancechurch.com/giving. There's black boxes on the back walls of the sanctuary area there, or you can connect with any of our ushers in that regard. A couple of things for today. As Lane mentioned, we have a bit of a missions emphasis going on today, kind of a two-pronged missions emphasis. We'll be hearing shortly from the Hostetters as they have a thank you for us and a little bit of an update, and then we'll also be hearing from Daniel Laborde, who, for those of you who are aware of his journey through YWAM here in recent months, he was on a missions trip, and he'll be sharing a little bit throughout service and during our grow group time today. So our normally scheduled grow groups will be meeting today starting at 11 a.m. here in the sanctuary. That's for all youth and adults. Daniel Laborde is going to be presenting about his mission trip experience, and we'll be engaging in some Q&A with him at 11 a.m. 6th or 12th grade students, we do have worship practice in the youth house today at noon, so following grow groups, you can head on over to the youth house. 6:30 p.m. tonight, senior high concept. Tomorrow is Ruby's Pantry. If you recall, Ruby's Pantry has moved across town, so volunteers can be there at 2:30 p.m. Or whatever time you're able to get there for registration and distribution. And as we look ahead throughout the week, there's a couple of things on the back of the bulletin here, and this actually isn't this upcoming week, but in future weeks. Our all-church work day is going to be on May 14th. There's info on the back of the bulletin there. There'll be a membership class that's taking place on May 15th, so if you have any questions about that, you can see Pastor Ryan, myself, or any of our elders. And if you look in that big center insert there in the middle of the bulletin, there's going to be a baptismal service on Sunday, May 22nd. And if you've given your life to Jesus Christ and you've not yet taken that step to be baptized, come talk to me. Come talk to Pastor Ryan. Talk to one of our elders. Talk to whoever you might be here with today, or those of you who are, you know, just engaging with each other as you're in service today. And we want to talk to you about that. We just want to chat with you a little bit about the importance of baptism, as it's a step of obedience that our Lord has modeled for us. And that's going to be coming up on May 22nd. There'll be a baptism class on May 1st. You know, a couple of weeks ago, my son picked up my Bible, this one right here, and he came running after me. And he starts going like this with it. He's going, I'm going to eat you with the Bible. And you know, I don't know. Yeah, thanks for that, buddy. Yep, that's absolutely where it happened, right? So he's coming after me like that. And, you know, I may or may not have modeled that for him. So I don't know what that says about me in that way. But, you know, I kind of quipped back to him at the time. I said, you know what, bud? There's worse things than being consumed by the Word of God. Far worse things than being consumed by the Word of God. Now, he didn't understand that. I was quite feeling proud of myself with that response right there, because it came in the moment, and my wife, she just rolled her eyes at me. But, you know, I was pretty proud of that. I thought, like, go team Holy Spirit, right? But there are far worse things than being consumed by the Word of God. In Hebrews chapter 12, we read this, starting in verse 24. You have come to Jesus, the one who mediates the new covenant between God and people, and to the sprinkled blood, which speaks of forgiveness instead of crying out for vengeance, like the blood of Abel. Be careful that you do not refuse to listen to the one who is speaking. For if the people of Israel did not escape when they refused to listen to Moses, the earthly messenger, we will certainly not escape if we reject the one who speaks to us from heaven. When God spoke from Mount Sinai, his voice shook the earth, but now he makes another promise. Once again, I will shake not only the earth, but the heavens also. This means that all of creation will be shaken and removed, so that only unshakable things will remain. And listen to this. Since we are receiving a kingdom that is unshakable, let us be thankful and please God by worshiping him with holy fear and awe. For our God is a consuming fire. Would you pray with me this morning? Jesus, I pray, Lord, that today we would be consumed by you, by our desire to surrender to you, to worship you, to rightly respond to you in everything that you've done for us. By your blood, Lord, our wounds are healed, and we are able to be in fellowship with you forever. You see us, Father, as righteous, and Lord, we're not righteous. But we are in your eyes. You say that we are, and we praise you for that. We thank you for that. And I pray, Lord, that your word today in this place would completely consume us, and that we would leave here differently than when we entered this morning. You are good, Lord. We trust you. We praise you. We worship you. We lift up the remainder of our time this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. For those of you who don't know the Hostetters, Chris, I'd like to invite you up. They are a missionary family that serves in New Guinea, and Chris has a couple of words here that he'd like to share with us this morning.
Thank you, Chris. Good morning. Just a couple things I want to share with you guys, two things I think you guys already know. First, God is awesome, and you guys are awesome. So you're like, yes, yeah, tell us something we don't know. We're raising money for a vehicle when we get back to Papua New Guinea. Actually, one note about that. Plane tickets are bought. We just bought plane tickets this past week, and we leave July 12th is when we leave Minnesota, headed on the long journey back to Papua New Guinea. But we're raising money for a vehicle when we get back there, a family vehicle for us. And we shared that need with you guys back, I think, in February, a couple months ago. And you guys responded awesomely. You guys have just poured out your generosity to us, and we want to say thank you for that this morning. So, kids that have come to Awana, thank you guys. Thank you, Awana program. We got a gift from you guys, and thank you, church family. You guys have raised almost $9,000 for us towards that vehicle. You guys just blew us away. God is just pouring out his blessings on us through you guys. Towards getting a vehicle. So we set a goal, a lofty goal of $25,000. Well, we're well on our way. So almost $9,000 from you guys. Now word has gone out to other churches, other people, other folks, and money's starting to pour in from them. We got another church that's committed $5,000. And so we're well on our way to reaching that goal. And it's just cool to see God provide for us and to see him using you guys to bless us in this way. So thank you guys for being part of that and being generous with us. So, yeah, thank you.
That's what I kind of like to do is if I invite a guest up here, and then just as that guest is stepping down and I step up, it's like you just applauded that I got up here. It's sweet to hear the reports of what's going on with Chris and Maggie and their family and how the Lord is providing for it. That was a huge aspect. When I first had those interactions with Chris about this vehicle, and he kind of shared me before we brought it to you guys, the dollar amount, I was like, seriously, that's huge. That's really, I mean, lofty just doesn't seem like a strong enough word. And yet we see what the Lord has been doing through us, that you guys, the Lord has placed that on you as well as these other churches. It's really fun, isn't it? It's fun to see what the Lord can do when we just kind of lay it out before him saying, hey, this is our need. I don't know what you got in mind for it. This is too big for us. And yet you see him do it. That's fun to be a part of that. And it's in a way then we get to be a part of, in a very big way, we get to be a part of what the Lord is doing in Papua New Guinea. And so we look forward to hearing more from Chris and Maggie when they obviously send reports back, but then they'll come back, I'm sure, and visit us again on their next furlough as well. Next, we're stepping into Daniel. So you, as Daniel comes up here, many of you may or may not know Daniel. Daniel is actually, you were practically born in this place.
Well, not in the building.
No, but close, okay? So Daniel's been part of this church since you were very young. When I first came here in 1999, you were barely talking, and now here, look at you, can complete full sentences. It's really, the distance we've come is astounding, Daniel.
Miss those times.
Right, I know. We do miss those times when you couldn't speak full sentences. But anyway, so you may not know Daniel. He went on a missions experience. It was a little bit of an extended one. Was it 6 months total, including the training? Okay, so he was 6 months. You may have realized, hey, it's been really quiet since Daniel's been gone. Well, Daniel's back now, and we get to hear from Daniel today. He's going to share a little bit, just a small piece of that here in the service aspect. But my heart and encouragement would be is if you hear Daniel and hear his heart and want to hear more, which I hope that you do, during our grow group time following the service, so from 11 to 11:45, Daniel's going to be back in here sharing more about his experience and also having an opportunity for question and answer time for it. If you don't know Daniel, you really need to get to know him, because that's the beauty of Daniel, is we can go back and forth like this and we have a mutual love for each other, I hope. And so I'm going to give him the microphone now, but just so he understands, I get it back, and so anything you say, canon will be used against you. All right, Daniel, let's hear what you...
As Ryan mentioned, I am back. I might even hang around a couple weeks this time. So everyone wants to find a place where they belong, and we all desire to have some sense of purpose. And I think that's because God made us to worship him. Everything we do, good or bad, points back to God somehow. And we all have that desire to bring glory to our Creator. But how do we do that? A lot of times we do so without even realizing it. About 7 months ago, I stood up here and talked about God asking me to go to YOM, and I was scared out of my mind what that would mean for me. I had no desire to pursue any schooling, I wasn't interested in missions, and by any secular standard, I was doing pretty well for myself. So to be perfectly honest, I really didn't want to go. But God asked me, so I did. In the time I was there, we spent 3 months in the classroom learning about God on a deeper level. Then we went to Mexico for 2 months on a missions trip. While I was there, God took the time to deal with a lot of things I didn't want to deal with, and he put me in a place where I couldn't get away from them either. But the biggest thing I see looking back at that is that no matter how much it hurt to get those things taken care of, he was there in every small detail and made sure that despite the difficulty of what had to be taken care of, I never had to do it alone. If there's one thing that God taught me in this time, it was how to obey him out of love instead of obligation. When I left in September, I went because he told me to and not for any other reason. Throughout most of the lecture phase, when people asked me why I was here, my answer was because God made it very clear this is what he wanted me to do. But as time went on, my heart was in it more and more, and despite the difficulty, I found myself slowly wanting to do it because I wanted to please God instead of because that's what I was told to do and I had to do what I was told. So later on, as Ryan mentioned, I will be giving you guys more details on everything, but for now I'd like to leave it at a thank you. Without the people here, I never would have had the means to do it. I never would have had the faith in God to do it. I never would have had the financial means to do it. And I'm very fortunate to have the family I have and the church family that I have here. God did a lot of work in me, and you guys all played a role in doing it. So I will leave you with that for now. If you want to know more, please hang around for Sunday school, and you can ask me whatever you want within reason.
There it is. There it is again. I stand up here, and you guys all give me an applause. Thank you so much. Really, really appreciate that. You know, Daniel said something, and it's going to fit so well with what we're going to be talking about today. He talked about, basically, he went off on his missions trip because he was told to. He knew he was supposed to. In other words, there was a leading from the Holy Spirit for him that was leading him to go on this missions trip. And then when he found that he was there, something had changed in him, and he actually wanted to be doing what God had doing for him. And as we wrap up today, as we look at this portion out of Galatians chapter 3, I think we're going to see that. There's going to be this glimpse of exactly what Daniel talked about there that's going to really, I hope, start kind of stirring within us and even a gut check, a heart check as to how does this pertain to us. If you're just joining us, today's your first Sunday. I just want to give you a brief recap of where we've been, how we got here, and where it is that we're heading. But we're going through the book of Galatians. Galatians is a book of the Bible. It's one of the New Testament epistles. It's a letter that Paul had written to not just one church, but to actually a series of churches in the region of Galatia. And one of the astounding things that he does with this letter in particular, and we see a lot of his philosophy, his beliefs, and the truths come through in a lot of his different letters. We're going to look at Philippians and Romans today as well as we engage in it, because they ring forth the same truth message, which is this gospel of grace. And so we'll see that all the way throughout. We'll see this message of righteousness, not on our own effort, but this message of righteousness because he has placed it on us. But in this book of Galatians, what we find is Paul's addressing these people. They have come to faith in Jesus Christ. They recognize this truth that Paul had preached to them when he went through on his missionary journey to their churches, to their cities, to their regions. And they put their faith in Christ, and then Paul hears this report back. And this report basically says all of these people, these Galatians, they're turning to a different gospel. And that's what we found in Galatians chapter 1. And when we look at it, this different gospel that's being referred to is the believers in Jesus are being swayed to believe that not only they need to believe in Jesus, but they also need something else. And specifically to this church and these churches in Galatia, they were being convinced that they needed to become Jews and all of the traditions with the Jews. They needed to obey what was known as the law and go through the customs to actually become Jewish, or their belief in Jesus Christ didn't count. And Paul's letter to the Galatian churches is really focused on that's wrong. He just flat out says that is absolutely false. Don't you believe it? If it got to be this point, and we're going to see this, I hope, very clearly today, if it got to be the point where if you do the right things, then you'll be accepted by God, then Jesus Christ died for nothing. And we'll see that verse here again this morning as we get started. So where we left off then, if you recall, we were in Galatians chapter 3, verse 15. We'll show that up here in a little bit. But when we look at this gospel of grace that Paul is permeating the Galatian people with, this gospel of grace, and he's saying it's all about grace. It's Jesus plus nothing. It's not Jesus plus works. It's not Jesus plus certain actions to be accepted by God, but it's Jesus and Jesus only. And when you come to believe that it's Jesus and Jesus only, you're actually credited with his righteousness. Last week, Easter, we had these golf cards. Remember that? These scorecards. And we painted this picture of if you were golfing on this golf scramble with Jesus, every time he hits the ball goes in the hole. 18 times in a row. It's perfect. And here we are trying to do the best that we can to add something to that score. You know, well, can't you use one of my strokes, Jesus? No, because you hit it in the rough. Well, can't you use one of mine? No, it's in the pond. I'm not going to strike the ball underwater. I don't even need to. And he puts the ball in the hole every single time. In other words, he's got an 18. And at the end of it, he basically says, here's the deal. Unless you score an 18, you can't be with me. You can't be in heaven. I say, well, I shot a 92. And that was just on the first hole. And Jesus says, you got to have an 18. And then he gives us his scorecard of the 18. And that's what I think we see when we look at Genesis 15:6. And this is what Paul quoted, if you remember in Galatians. This is the point. He said, when Abraham believed, it was credited to him as righteousness. In other words, Jesus gave him the scorecard. And Abraham said, okay, I get it. I understand. And that's what we were faced with last week. And when you take the scorecard, you have a credit all of a sudden that says, wow, I got an 18, and I did nothing to deserve it. That's the grace. That's the picture that we're painting when we talk about this gospel. That is what Paul wants us to understand. And that's why Abraham received this credit, and likewise, that's what's being offered to us. That's where we left off last week. So now here we were left with the question, inevitably, well, this we talked about this the week before, then let's hit it on this. You remember 2 weeks ago, Palm Sunday, we asked this question, but before we got into this question, remember we had the two tables and then we had the altar in between. So we had this one table, we had the cheesecake. Remember? Delicious cheesecake. I heard some people say they don't like cheesecake afterwards. You're wrong. And on this side, we had the skunk. Right? Remember? That represented me, the skunk. And in between then, we had the rules, the law that came up. In order to get the cheesecake, we had to obey the rules, but these rules were impossible to keep. And so in other words, what we looked at was, here you have this promise that was made to Abraham, and in the middle of it, you have this set of rules that I'm blocked. There's this barrier. I can't get to the promise because I'm just a skunk. And then what we found and we talked about is Jesus was the way that day. Well, this is where we left off. And I want to just recap before we step in because this raised a question that I really want us to look at and focus on today. So it says here in Galatians chapter 3, verse 15, it says, brothers and sisters, let me take an example from everyday life. Just as no one can set aside or add to a human covenant that has been duly established, so it is in this case. What Paul is pointing to is basically the will and testament. He's saying, if you, as a person, have offspring, or whether you have offspring or not, you have someone that you want to leave your inheritance with, I'm available. If you have this group, thank you, Pam, I appreciate that. I expected more laughter, I gotta be honest, but Pam, you're sharp enough, thank you for that. Anyway, you have this set of, you have these heirs, it's like, I want to leave my inheritance with them, and so what do? I create a set of rules, I create this document that says, this is it. I'm leaving this and this and this all to them. And then when I die, can someone else come and say, oh, that's not what he meant? No, that's the point. I got to decide who's going to receive the inheritance. Then when I die, that's when it comes to fruition. That's what Paul's talking about here. So when he says, when we have this set of this promise, that that's what's going to be promised, it doesn't matter. Someone else can say, well, that's not going to work for me. You've got to be 18. Well, it didn't say 18. we go with, you follow what Paul's getting at. So this is the idea of the will and testament. And he says, the promises that were spoken to Abraham, to his seed, singular, and Paul, remember we broke this down. Scripture does not say, and to seeds, plural. It's talking about one person, talking about Jesus Christ, many people, but and to your seed, meaning one person who is Christ. 17, he says, what I mean is this, the law introduced 430 years later after the promise of the cheesecake, which we had symbolized there, does not set aside the covenant previously established by God and thus do away with the promise. For if the inheritance depends on the law, then it no longer depends on the promise. But God in his grace gave it to Abraham through a promise. It led us to this question. So what's the purpose of the law? Remember we asked that question 2 weeks ago. With all of this, he's given us a promise. But what's the point then of the law if the law can't let us get into the promise? Why give us the law if the law doesn't save us? What's the purpose? What's the point? And that's what we see Paul actually even asking. Why then was the law given at all? Some of us view the law like a ladder. I would say most of mankind, we like to view the law as a ladder. You know, and then the reality of it is, okay, I got certain rules that I'm going to achieve as I go in this life, and I look at these rules. Okay, thou shalt not kill thine mother. It's not quite in there that way, but let's just say I haven't killed my mother yet, and so I make a step up the ladder. I'm doing okay. And then maybe the next law is, well, thou shalt not, you know, commit adultery. Well, I haven't done that yet. And then Jesus comes down on the scene and says, well, if you lust after a woman, it's like, ooh, I'm not sure where I should stand. I haven't committed adultery, but there is that. I don't know. I'm a little bit more unsure of myself. Thou shalt not gossip. Well, let's see. I don't really gossip. Well, I shared that one thing as a prayer request. I guess that's not going to be gossip, so I'll climb up the ladder. And that's what we do. We treat it as a set of rules that loft me up. And then I look at my life. At least I'm better than that person. At least I'm not like that. At least I don't struggle with that. And we kind of look at it as another reason to, oh, I can get up higher. By the way, ladder safety training day, this is not safe, okay? Well, notice only 2 points are touching the ladder right now. That is a no-no. Consider yourselves trained in ladder safety, okay? But here's the idea, and Paul got into this in Philippians chapter 3. Look at what Paul says. Okay, though I myself, I have reasons to have such confidence. He's saying basically to people, you guys, you think that you have all of this going for you, and yet you're foolish. You know, you don't know what in the world you're doing. I can go a little bit higher, I think. You don't know what in the world you're doing. You think you're all that? You think you're so smart? You think you're doing all of the right things? But in truth, you're not. If it were just based on your actions, I would have more reason to be higher on the ladder. I can look down on you. So he says in Philippians chapter 3, he says, though I myself have reasons for such confidence. In other words, I'm higher up the ladder than you ever were. If someone else thinks that they have reasons to put confidence in the flesh, I have more. Circumcision on the eighth day. Of the people of Israel, I'm a Jew of Jews. I'm from the tribe of Benjamin. So each one, he can go higher and higher and higher. Where are you? You're way down there. In regards to the law, a Pharisee, as for zeal, persecuting the church, as for righteousness based on the law, I was at the top. This is actually safe because I have 2 feet and a hand on, okay? Also consider yourselves duly trained. But then he changes it. He says, wait a minute. I came to this realization. I was doing all of these things. I was so high on that ladder. And then I came to realize all of those steps that I was taking, it's garbage. Look at what he says. But whatever these gains were, all of my steps of self-righteousness, I consider them loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from obeying the rules of the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. This is the purpose of the law. Look at this. This is what Paul says in Galatians chapter 3, verse 19. So he says, what is it then? What is the purpose of the law? Why do we even have it? And he says, the law was added. In other words, it came after the promise. We talked about that 2 weeks ago. The law was added because of transgressions, because of sin. This is really astounding when you consider it. The law was added because of sin. In other words, there's two factors here that boil into it. People were sinful, and the law had to be added to reveal their sin. And it actually made sin worse. And we're going to see that here. The reality of it is looking at this way. You know, this is a picture of what the law does. It reveals to me, great, Scott, I didn't shave today. If I had had the law sooner, I could have at least cleaned my face for you. But yet what's interesting is the law has no power to clean my face. You see? The law has no power to shave off my face. It does reveal that I am a grotesque person who's graying and balding, and I should have shaved. It shows me who I really am. That's what the law does. And that's what Paul is getting at here, is the law reveals your true self. It's not this ladder that you climb to gain some self-righteousness. The law, when you look at it, reveals your depravity. It reveals the need that you have for a razor or hair dye or mole removal. And we can't do that. The law has no power to do those things. The law is there to reveal your depravity. I don't want to look at the law. I don't want to see my depravity. I'd rather focus on climbing the ladder. Because at least if I get partway up, I can look down on someone else. That's what we do. Some of us, though, we're so busy looking at sitting at the bottom, realizing, I'll never get up that high. We look at others who we see as so lofty. Both are forms of self-righteousness. And so he's saying there's no righteousness that you have on your own. The righteousness comes from Christ. The law reveals your heart. The law reveals your sin. The next portion I have up here, just so you understand, it's very confusing. I don't understand it. Most scholars don't understand it. I'm showing it to you because I like to be that way, where we cover the full gamut of the book that we're studying. And so just understand, we don't understand this. Paul, I believe, did fully understand, but it doesn't diminish this message that he's got here. But what we find here is the law was given through the angels and entrusted to a mediator. And who that mediator is this referring to Moses? Is this referring to the Holy Spirit? Is this referring to Jesus? Scholars kind of go back and forth. Let's be honest, we don't know, but it does not diminish the truth of what we're looking at. A mediator, however, implies more than one party, but God is one. And again, most people just look at Paul, I'm not following what you're getting at here. Would the Galatians have understood it? Very possible, because he was writing that letter to the Galatians. And in their context, they may have been able to grasp, but here we are in our North America, we just don't know. And most scholars just don't know that answer. So if you come to me afterwards and say, what do you mean by that? Okay. But then we get into verse 21. He says, is the law therefore opposed to the promise? In other words, you have this law, you have the cheesecake. Is this opposed? Are they two separate entities in that way? He says, absolutely not. For if a law had been given that could impart life, then righteousness would certainly have come by the law. If we look at the Ten Commandments, if we look at the law of God, if I can obey all of these things, I'll get up that ladder. If I can get up that ladder, then I can have life. Interestingly, in Genesis chapter 11, that's exactly what we see happening. You have a group of people that decide to build a tower. And their goal is, if we build this tower, we can get up to God. And God looks at them and he says, you're fools. If you ever think you can get to me by building a tower, you're so self-righteous. You'll never get it. And so he actually confuses the language, Tower of Babel, if you know what I'm talking about, confuses their language and sets them away, because here's the deal. You're not getting it. There's no righteousness in yourself. It's not going to come from your own works. It's not going to come from getting up the ladder on your own. It comes from revealing who you actually are, and the fact that when I look at that mirror, I realize I need some help. I realize I need help. The law reveals the fact that I need help. The law is therefore, is it opposed? Absolutely not. For if a law had been given that could impart life, then righteousness would certainly have come by the law. If I could earn righteousness on my own, then what do we find in Galatians chapter 2? I do not set aside the grace of God, for if righteousness could be gained through the law, Christ died for nothing. Christ died for nothing. And that's not the truth. If Christ died, was buried, and rose again, like we celebrated last week, then there's a reason for it, and it's not to obey the law. The law does not bring life. So the first and foremost, what does this law do? This law reveals my state. It reveals who I really am. It reveals my depravity. When I look at the law, I should see the fact that I am broken and I am desperately in need of a Savior. But the law does something else. This is an astounding passage of Scripture in verse 22. I don't know that I've ever looked at it quite this way, but this is just jaw-dropping when you look at it. So it says, Paul writes, the Scripture, referring to the Old Testament, he says, has locked up everything under the control of sin. In other words, he's saying the law has imprisoned us. Scripture has thrown us into a prison. Who says that? Who thinks that? We look at the Scriptures being freeing. But Paul's actually saying, don't you understand this law that we're talking about actually locks you up? It imprisons you. Why? I think so many times we go through our life, we don't realize that we're imprisoned by the law. And Paul's saying, you're locked up in prison, and I need you to see that. Because when we see the reality that we are stuck, like we said, with no promise, we can't get to the promise because we're stuck. When we suddenly realize that we're stuck, then we realize I need someone to unlock this. I need someone to make a way. And so when Paul says this, but the Scripture has locked up everything under the control of sin so that what was promised, being given through faith in Jesus, might be given to those who believe. In other words, there's only one way out of this prison, and it's not through doing the right things. It's not through climbing the ladder. It's through what we talked about several weeks ago. It's through belief. It's through belief that Jesus Christ came and opened the gate and let us out. It's interesting, even for those of us who have come to faith in Jesus Christ, and we came to this realization that I'm stuck, I'm depraved, I need a Savior, and we say, Jesus, free me, Jesus, save me, and He does. The gate is open. And yet sometimes I think we stay in the cage because that's where we're comfortable. We're comfortable knowing this lifestyle. I'm not comfortable going out of this cage and what that's going to lead to. We have a dog. He's our favorite dog. He's also our least favorite. But at one point we taught him we had to sleep in the kennel. And I just, because I thought it was funny, I would put him in the kennel and I would close the door, but I wouldn't latch it. So all he had to do was push it open. The door's unlocked. But the silly thing would stay there. And he would stay there and he'd stay there. I enjoyed the fact that he was stuck in this cage with that gate closed but not latched. Likewise, I think we do the same thing sometimes. We're sitting in this cage of the law when Jesus Christ has set us free. But I'm comfortable inside my rules. I'm comfortable inside my law. I'm comfortable as long as I know what's next and what I have to do. You know, Daniel shared that story very briefly. I'm comfortable. But God laid out something for him, and he had to take some steps of faith, and he found that something beautiful is on the other side of it. So, we find that the law not only reveals to us our sin, but it actually imprisons us. Romans 3 speaks to this. He says, this righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile. And then we see this very well-known verse in 23. He says, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. It makes no difference if I have committed adultery. And I should take a step down. It makes no difference if I lust. It makes no difference if I've killed. It makes no difference if I have done all those things right and I'm way at the top of the ladder. I'm earning self-righteousness. We're all in the same boat, and that boat's sinking. And we need someone to save us from the sinking boat. But Scripture has locked up everything, this is that verse, under the control of sin so that what was promised being through faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. Look at this contrast in Romans 7. What shall we say then? Is the law sinful? Certainly not. The law doesn't lead us to sin. Nevertheless, I would not have known what sin was had it not been for the law. For I would not have known what coveting was. I didn't know I was a mess until the law was there to reveal the fact that I am a mess. Do you get it? Do you follow? For I would have not known what coveting really was if the law had not said, you shall not covet. I said, but sin then, seizing the opportunity afforded by the commandment, produced in me every kind of coveting. In other words, sin even got worse when the law came into being. For apart from the law, sin was dead. Once, before I looked in the mirror, I thought I looked pretty good. Before I looked in the mirror, I didn't see anything wrong with myself. I was actually alive. I was doing fine. I was good. But then when the law was revealed to me, when the commandment came, sin sprang to life and I died. I found that the very commandment that I was intended to bring, that was intended to bring life, actually brought death. When I looked in the mirror, it's like, wow, I really am ruined. This is interesting. We like to see ourselves in a light, I'll be honest, it's just, we like to see ourselves at the top of the ladder. Or at least enough of a way up the ladder where I can look down on some people, realizing that there's some people who are much higher than myself. But as long as I had someone that I can look down on, I can feel pretty good. Look at what C.S. Lewis says. He says, prostitutes. In other words, those who are stuck in the sin that we in our culture would look at as like, oh, you're in the lows of the lows. Prostitutes are in no danger of finding their present life as satisfactory that they cannot turn to God. In other words, prostitutes are, they're in no danger of seeing their life as being, ah, my life is so good, I don't need God or anything. They're in no danger of that. And then he switches it, and look at this. This is astounding. He says, the proud, well, I'm not proud. At least I'm not as proud as you are. Isn't that a funny statement? The wealthy, let's be honest, most of us live a pretty comfortable life. I know, you may not feel like you do, but compared to some of those in the rest of the world, we do. The wealthy. When I'm wealthy, I don't need God. I can live just fine without him. The self-righteous. I'm not self-righteous, I'm just better than you. Come on. Let's own it. I'm guilty perhaps more than anyone. So let's just own it. Let's just call a spade a spade. We're the ones that are in danger of thinking that we don't need a God. We don't even know it. Isn't that something? Oh, James 2 writes of this. Can you imagine? Just imagine with me. Now, Jesus, we just celebrated his life, his death, his burial, resurrection. And he gives us this freedom. He gives us his grace because he lived a perfect life. If he had sinned just once, remember the Satan tempting him out in the desert? If he had sinned just once, all of this would be nothing. We'd have nothing. If he sinned just once, we'd have nothing. Satan knew it. That's why Satan absolutely wanted to tempt him. And the Bible says he was tempted in every single way. So you think, well, he hasn't been tempted in this way. Yeah, he was. Everything that we deal with, every one of us, he was tempted in every single way. So don't think he got out early. He was tempted in every way. And if he had messed up just once, this is what would be true for him. Whoever keeps the whole law and yet stumbles at just one point is guilty of breaking all of it, and we'd be stuck. There we are. I'm so self-righteous. You know what that means? I could be at the top of the ladder, and I miss one thing. Where do I go? A step down? I'd demonstrate this for you, but my health would not do well. No, we'd fall to the ground. Do you see the difference? It's not just taking a step down. It's plummeting. That's what the mirror reveals to us. John Stott says this, it is only against the inky blackness of the night sky that the stars begin to appear, and it is only against the dark background of sin and judgment that the gospel shines forth. In other words, this mirror reveals this fact. Lord, I am in desperate need of a Savior. Some of you perhaps are here, it's like, I don't feel a need for God because you see yourself as, I'm off the ladder high enough, I'm good. Some of us may feel like I can't accept God because I'm, in a sense, that prostitute. Everyone else is higher than me. I'm the lowest of the lows. But yet you see your need for it. And guess what? He's offering it to you just as much as he's offering to anyone else. There's a final picture that we have as far as the purpose of the law. So Galatians chapter 3 says, before the coming of this faith, we were held in custody. In other words, this law actually is what the phrasing, the terminology is actually twofold. One would be a guard. In other words, we're kind of guarded, we're in prison, and you have this guard that's kind of in charge of you. And the other is a tutor, someone that's actually training and teaching you these things. And it says, so before the coming of this faith, we were held in custody under the law, locked up until, the faith that was to come would be revealed. In other words, this is temporary. And this tutor would be in charge of these kids. This is Israel history, okay? And basically what they would do is they'd be in charge of these kids, and they would be in charge of them, and they could discipline them, they could yell at them, they were like parents to them. They could do whatever they wanted to until they hit a certain age, and then the time came that they would go out. They were free from the tutor at that point. He's saying basically the law was kind of like that. It's this tutor until the person, Jesus, of faith comes, and then it changes, and that's what we're looking at here. So the law was our guardian until Christ came that we might be justified by faith. Now that is faith. Now that this faith has come, we are no longer under a guardian. And so this is what it kind of boils down to. So we have the law, the mirror that reveals to us our need for sin. But what do we do with this now? Okay? How does this affect us now? And the reality of it is the law still is in existence. And so it serves this purpose. But sometimes we look at this ladder that this law is supposed to be ascending us to, that we can climb this ladder and look down on it, and that's not what it is. It's a path. The law is a path. But we don't navigate this path on our own. The Holy Spirit, in a sense, is this path that's taking us. This is the direction I want to go. Because we look at the law, it's not bad things. Are you saying that I should commit adultery? Are you saying that I should lust? Are you saying that I should kill? Absolutely not. These are precepts that God has called us to, but we can't do it on our own. Instead, we have the Spirit. And the Spirit lays the tracks for us and says, this is what I need you to do. Follow me. He lays out the path for us. And like a train following the tracks is a Christian following the Spirit, going around mountains, going up the hills, going in the valleys, going through hard spots, going through joyful areas, praising God all the way. Do you see the difference? The law is good. Final story, and I'll invite the worship team to come up. And this is what I emailed and talked about. The picture that came to my mind is as a child, when I'm living in my home, I'm under certain rules in my home, mostly the rules of my father, my mother and father. But my dad was the authoritarian in the home, and so when he had a rule, we obeyed the rule. And if that rule wasn't followed, there were consequences. There was punishment for it, and rightly so. And one of the rules, and I talked about this in my email, and I remember this day, my older brother and I were in the kitchen, and we had back-talked our mother. I didn't know Dad was home yet. We'd sassed Mom, and it was great. She's meek, she is mild, she is Mom, and when she gets mad and spanks us, it doesn't even hurt. You know what I'm talking about. It's true. What do you got to threaten me with? And as I'm sassing her, out of nowhere, I didn't even know he was there, come these two hands. And I kid you not, the next thing I knew, my brother and I were elevated and pinned up against the wall, staring at his cold blue eyes. And he laid into us about the rules. You don't tell your mother no. I would have saluted if I could have got my hand up. And so I remember that moment. And the interesting contrast now, I'm away from home. My mom calls me and wants me to do something. I have every right to tell her no. But yet I'm drawn to tell her yes. Why? Because of a love relationship. I desire to follow the laws of God. Why? Because it's going to earn me a salvation? It's going to earn me his acceptance? Absolutely not. But because I love him and he loves me, there's still a purpose for the law. Don't just dismiss it. It's good. And the Holy Spirit wants us to follow that path. Let's worship this God who has given us such a good law for a good purpose.
Will you stand and sing with us?
of Abraham, you're the God of covenant, of faithful promises. Time and time again, you have proven you'll do just what you say. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast. And let my heart learn when you speak a word will come to pass. Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me.
Yeah. God from age to age, the earth may pass away, your word remains the same. Your history can prove there's nothing you can do, you're faithful and true. God, and he gives us promises, and we want to put our faith in Jesus, and it's so sweet to trust in Jesus. Sing along as Eliza and Carissa lead us.
to trust in Jesus and to take him at his word, just to rest upon his promise and to know the says the
I've heard you can take what's broken and make it whole again. Well, here's the pieces of my heart. What can you do with them? 'Cause I can't hold them all together anymore. So I let
things as we conclude our time together. Number one, I don't want, I didn't come up with this illustration. I saw that somewhere years ago, so I don't want any credit for that, just FYI. But you might be here and it's like, wow, this is, I've always felt like I need to do something to earn God's favor. This might be a new message to you, and that's the reality and the truth of what we've just read and what we've just learned is that's not the case. It's belief in Jesus Christ. It's belief that you need a Savior and that Jesus Christ is offering it to you. That's the gospel. And so if you've come and it's like, wow, I've done nothing to deserve it. I've done nothing to earn it. You're right, but there's still a way. For others of us, we may still wrestle with measuring our Christianity based on what I do. And if you're wanting to measure by what you're doing, are you following the Holy Spirit? Because I think it's a lot of times clearer than we really would like to admit. Are you following the Holy Spirit? Is the Spirit leading you down this path? Is the Spirit leading you to criticize? Is the Spirit leading you to love? I think the Spirit has laid out a track for us. We do have a responsibility to obey the Spirit. That is what the Lord leads us to do. And so we are called to obey. We are called to obey the Spirit. The law cannot save you. Jesus Christ has done that. So for some of us, we may be wrestling with that. Some of us, maybe it's just like, well, I don't know that I can ever stop measuring my Christianity by works. Measure it with your faith in Jesus Christ. He's done the work. He's climbed the ladder. I don't have to. I can't. So take encouragement with that. Let me pray. Lord, thank you for the work that you've done and for this message again of this gospel, of this grace. And I mentioned to the team this morning, Lord, I'm confronted with your grace. And every time I think that, wow, this grace is better than I thought, and I came to it again today, it's like this grace is better than I thought. And that was just even as of last week. I can't live without your grace. I can't. We can't live without your grace. So, Lord, I pray that your Spirit will move on us in such a way that we will realize that we cannot live without your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Be back here at 11 o'clock. Thank you, Joey. Be back here at 11 o'clock for Daniel. Otherwise, there's coffee and some goodies out there.